If you're able, let's stand together and please turn your attention to your word of worship as we hear our God call us to worship him this Lord's Day. The Lord reigns. Let the peoples tremble.
He is the throne of the king's chair. Let the earth quake.
The Lord is great in Zion.
He is exalted above all peoples.
Let them praise your great and awe-inspiring name.
He is holy. Amen.
And amen. Please remain standing for our first hymn.
Here is My Jesus, I Love Thee.
Today's scripture lesson comes from Philippians chapter 3 and verse 1. That's found on page 1165, 1165 of the Blue Pew Bible in front of you. And I'll be reading a little bit past today's text. This is God's word to us. Finally, my brothers, rejoice in the Lord. To write the same things to you is no trouble to me and is safe for you. Look out for the dogs. Look out for the evildoers. Look out for those who mutilate the flesh. For we are the circumcision who worship by the Spirit of God and glory in Christ Jesus, and put no confidence in the flesh. Though I myself have reason for confidence in the flesh also. If anyone else thinks he has reasons for confidence in the flesh, I have more. Circumcised on the eighth day of the people of Israel, the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews. As to the law, a Pharisee. As to zeal, a persecutor of the church. As to righteousness under the law, blameless. But whatever gain I had, I counted as loss for the sake of Christ. Indeed, I count everything as loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. For his sake, I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish in order that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which comes through faith in Christ. The righteousness from God that depends on faith, that I may know him in the power of his resurrection and may share his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, that by any means possible, I may attain the resurrection from the dead. Amen. Let's pray. Gracious God, we pray that by your Holy Spirit, your word would resound to our hearts, to our minds, to our wills, to our conduct, and to our speech. That by your Holy Spirit, you would take what is written here and make it living and active in our lives and the lives of your whole church, so that we may be encouraging and beneficial and upbuilding toward one another, and that we may be salt and light to our friends and neighbors. In your Son's name, amen. Dad and a son are in church listening to a sermon. And the son turns to his dad and says, "Daddy, what does it mean when the pastor says finally?" And the dad says to the son, "Nothing, son. It means nothing. Is not happening here in Philippians 3:1. Yes, I know our English translations say, finally, and a good, easy, obvious joke to make is we're only halfway through the letter, and Paul says finally, but really, he's just bringing to conclusion the topic of chapter 2, which is unity based on humility. What's the humility based on? Seeing Christ, who laid aside all of his glory for the ignominy of the cross. So Paul means he's done talking about that. About unity based on humility, based on the gospel. Now he's going to talk about something else. So by finally, he doesn't mean I'm going to wind this up in the next 3 or 4 minutes so that everyone can get a good lunch spot. No, Paul means I'm done talking about that and finally going to talk about this next topic. And then the second verse takes one of the sharpest turns you see in the entire New Testament, but not so fast there. So he says, finally. Finally, he says, my brothers, rejoice in the Lord. Oh, how easy it would be, especially in the book of Philippians. We see this a dozen other times. There's 13 mentions of joy and rejoicing. Oh, how easy it would be for us to just skip on past that. Yeah, 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 Christians should pretend like they're happy. Yeah, 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 that's what rejoice means. We know that. We got that bit, Paul. But he says, finally, rejoice in the Lord. And then he says, you're tired of it? Oh, you're tired of it? Well, it's no skin off my nose. No big difficulty for me to be repetitive. And by the way, it's very safe for you to be repetitive. So let's take some apostolic advice here. Let's not be such prideful people. Let's stop, sit there, and stew in Paul the Apostle's advice, which is repetition is not bad. Okay, there. All right. Rejoice in the Lord. Now think about it. Think about the dripping irony of the situation. Here it is. You are sitting in a climate-controlled room. Beneath your back and rear ends, soft, carpety, pillowy pleasure. You will exit this church and likely get into a $35,000 car, also with plush seats, and also climate controlled. And oh, if you're just a wee bit uncomfortable, you can adjust the seat in your car again, probably, not all of us. You can adjust the seat of your car and remain in the perfect physical comfort, only to arrive at your kitchen or restaurant where hundreds and thousands of food that to previous generations belonged in other continents, in other country, can just be summoned to your lunch plate in a matter of mere minutes. And the person speaking to you right now is chained in shame on either side, as Pastor Mike said last Sunday morning, with the equivalent of a professional killer, a Navy SEAL chained to him on either side. By the way, the Empire of Rome was not as nice as the United States. They didn't fund their federal prisons. Paul still had to pay rent, and he still had to eat on his own dime, while chained to two professional killers. Therefore, one of the most shameful things I think that can happen to a man, now Paul is put in the position where he's not only in chains to two professional killers, way, 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 way far away from Israel, Tarsus, all of his home bases, he's all the way in Rome. Not only that, he has to depend on the kindness and generosity of other people to pay for his rent and to bring him food. So I think it's ironic. In fact, I think it's the definition of ironic. We here, sitting in our plush luxury, hearing the words of a man in prison, and what is he telling us? Rejoice in the Lord. And what do Americans in 2024 say? We are more medicated than anyone has ever been medicated. We are more depressed than anyone has ever been depressed. We are more filled full of anxiety and fear than anyone has ever been afraid. The following statement is just one man's opinion, which is pretty much worthless. I don't know how much time you spend around people who are less than 40 years old and outside of Christianity, outside of the church. Here's my bold prediction. I don't see the problem getting better. Suicide, mental illness. The person in prison with nothing is saying, rejoice. The people hearing the prisoner speak, if we were to be honest with ourselves, we have everything. And we couldn't be more miserable with our stuff. And I don't mean us, I mean as a society, as America. We couldn't be more miserable. And Paul says, rejoice. Who's saying rejoice? The one who gets made fun of, scoffed, mocked. The one who gets stones thrown at him. The one who gets put in prison. Many of those, not a fair trial. And he says to you, he says to your ears, rejoice. Therefore, Rejoice has to be something different. It just must be something different than our circumstances. And if you've lived more than, 10 or 12 years, you know that rejoice has to be something than just emotion, something that you feel. And often the circumstances determine our feelings. And so if joy is not to be found in circumstances, and if joy is not to be just waited upon and one day it'll hit us in some emotional, overwhelming salvo, then to rejoice must be something that we have the control over. In fact, for Christian people, start listening now, okay? Please start listening. In fact, for Christian people, joy is the fruit of the Spirit, which means if you are a Christian, joy is inevitable. That's what fruit are. They're inevitable to the type of tree they are. If you're an apple tree, the fruit will be apple. If you're a Christian tree, one of the fruit will be joy. Inevitable that a fruit of being engrafted into the Holy Spirit is joy. And joy is not found in circumstance. And joy cannot be mere emotion. And so what is it? It is our constant view of who and what we have and who we are in Christ. That right now we have a good shepherd with a rod and a staff. And we have goodness and mercy following us all the days of our lives. And at the very, very, very worst of circumstances, what can evil do to us? Oh, here's what evil can do to us. Usher us into eternal bliss and paradise. Right now, you have a Heavenly Father. Right now, you have a Good Shepherd. Right now, you have the Spirit of God alive and work in your members, working joy into your life. Your future is basically this. Your very, very, very worst day in the new creation is infinitely better than your very, very best day in this life. I dare you to walk around with a mopey face the rest of your life and actually believe that. Can Christians be sad? By all means. Can Christians be depressed and afraid? By all means. But the controlling principle of our lives, the deepest root, is joy. And Paul says, you know what? We need to hear that more than once. So it's no trouble for me to be a repetitive pastor. And it's also safe for my congregations to be a repetitive pastor. So let's just get this out of the way right now. We're going to keep saying the same stuff. Do you agree with that? Okay.
Amen. Amen.
In fact, if you hear a pastor or Bible study that is very often saying new stuff, that is a giant red flag. And I'm so tempted by this. I was watching what another church was doing, and then I thought, well, when our church starts Advent this year, then we better do something. And then I thought, no, you know, let's just save us all the time. Guess what's going to happen at Advent this year? We're going to talk about the birth of Jesus, and we're going to sing songs about the birth of Jesus. The same thing that has always been happening at Advent in the Christian faith. And so Paul says, listen, rejoice in the Lord. Always. Again, he says, rejoice. Rejoice in the Lord. And it's no trouble for me to keep preaching the same message, which is to rejoice in the Lord. Now, if I could sit down after preaching Philippians 3:1, many of us would be happy. But then all of a sudden, in a surprise attack, all of a sudden, almost out of nowhere, there's Philippians 3:2. And I don't know how familiar you are, how many times a year or how many times per life you've just quickly read through Paul's 13 letters. This is not how Paul generally speaks. This is not some verbally abusive bully who is just wild and out of control with his words. No, Paul is very measured. He uses grand descriptions of God and his glory, but addressing specific human sin, Paul's very gracious and patient and merciful most of the time. What in the world is going on in Philippians 3:2? Beware of dogs? Beware of evildoers? Beware of flesh mutilators? Okay, Paul. Obviously, you're using some metaphor here. Who are these dogs that I shouldn't spend any time listening to? Evil, that's putting it strongly. Who are evildoers and flesh mutilators? I feel like I pretty much steer clear of people who mutilate their flesh already. So I could understand Paul mentioning this maybe at the end of the letter. But to shout beware three straight times in a row of dogs, evildoers, and flesh mutilators, it seems like something is very important to Paul, but it's very obscure and hard for us to take seriously because we have never known what Philippians 3:2 meant, and yet we've been fine our whole lives. And so what is Paul so mad about? Well, I don't know if you've ever been to a country that doesn't treat dogs as pets. I've been to a few countries that don't treat dogs as pets, and so you're in a city square, and if you happen to see a dog, it's made up of about 72 different breeds, and it's got, you know, three legs, and it's scrounging through the trash. And so I think even in our culture, some of us wouldn't, but many of us, even in our culture, would be offended if somebody took your humanity and called you a dog. But there's a problem with us being called dogs, and that is we're thinking of a beautiful, you know, golden retriever lying across our laps, all beautiful fur and well-behaved, and we think, aw, pets are dogs. Dogs are pets. But it's not so in Philippi. Paul's thinking of these wretched, three-legged, trash-eating, disease-ridden animals. And Paul is calling a group of people that. And he's warning the Philippians not to listen to the group of people that he is calling that. Well, Paul's doing something heavily ironical, which is this. Traditionally, the Jews have called all the non-Jews, yep, you guessed it, dogs. And now a group of Jewish Christians has infiltrated the Philippian church. And they've started to imply something wrong. And so Paul has turned the tables on them and said, no, actually, you know who the real dogs are? The real dogs are the Jewish Christians who have infiltrated your pulpit and your Sunday school and your Bible study. And here's what they are. Evildoers. But wait a second. These false teachers who have infiltrated the Philippian pulpit, They're saying that we need to obey God and do good and work works of righteousness. And Paul's saying, no, there's a certain spin, there's a certain twist that while they are proclaiming righteousness, they're actually evildoers. And the very rite, the very ceremony of entrance into God's people that they take so much pride and glory in, circumcision, to God's eyes, to God's heart, is actually a mutilation of the flesh. And so whatever these false teachers were teaching, we need to be aware of, because it's a big deal to Paul, it should be a big deal to us. So what were these false teachers teaching? You must obey the law of Moses in order to be saved. You must be circumcised in order to be saved. You must obey all of the Old Testament law in order to be saved. In order to become part of God's people, You must obey all 10 commandments, but you can't even begin to obey all 10 commandments unless you first take the mark, go through the rite of entrance into the community of people who obey God's 10 commandments. In the New Testament, that happens to be baptism. But these false teachers in the pulpit are saying, no, if you're a Gentile, lost, alien in your culture, I'll tell you what to do. You don't need to live by faith. You don't need to pray for wisdom. I'll tell you what to do. All 600 plus laws. I'll tell you exactly how to live. Here's how you Gentile people need to get to Christ. You can't go directly to the cross. No, first go back to the Old Testament, become a Jew, and then after you've walked through the entire Old Testament, then you're ready for Christ. And Paul says, beware of anyone who teaches you that. Applied contemporarily, since I don't believe we've had any guest speakers in our pulpit who've implied any sort of flesh mutilation, is the much more sinister teaching of all false teachers. Here's what they do. They rarely come in through the front doors. They come in through the side doors by preaching the gospel, preaching the gospel less, assuming the gospel, adding things, and then a whole generation sits under preaching of assuming the gospel, other things added, and then the next generation comes along, and the things added replace the gospel, and then all of a sudden, you've lost the entire church. And so we say, oh, that seems harmless, because we have the gospel, and you're bringing this in, and I don't really see that anywhere in the Bible, but I'm going to go ahead and accept it. We're tolerant, merciful, gracious, generous people here as Christians. And my goodness, how many sermons could I possibly hear about my own wretchedness and the righteousness of Christ and how he took my place on the cross and therefore I get his heaven because he took my hell, and when God looks at me, I'm robed in his righteous robes. And you know, I kind of know that already. So bring it on. Bring on some of that new stuff. And you know, the people who do that new stuff, they really are very attractive in their personalities, and they obviously that they can't be stupid because thousands of people are following them. Let's bring in some of that new teaching. And then moments later, we are an apostate. People going through the motions. False church. Why? Because we left the side door open a little bit. And some dogs ran in. We let down our guard, and some evildoers walked in. We weren't sharp and proactive and holding each other accountable to the gospel, and flesh mutilators showed up. And Paul says, that is not Christianity. Christianity is Christ crucified. And that message placarded before people in word, in sacrament, week after week. That's what the people of God need. A steady, constant, even if it's boring to you, diet of the cross of Christ, the righteousness of Christ. Without invention, in many cases even creativity, novelty, those things belong in the business world, in advertising. They don't belong in the Christian church. The Christian church is rooted in the historic gospel, and that same gospel that converts us to Christ also carries us through our entire Christian life. It's enough. It's enough. It's enough. And when we let people in and say it's not a big deal, all of a sudden, the sheep mask come off underneath. It was always a wolf looking to devour us whole. By the way, side note. By the way, footnote. You look at the warnings in Paul and Peter's letters. I can't find anywhere where Paul or Peter are worried about the culture, the evil culture, destroying the church from the outside. But in every book, I can see Paul and Peter worried about a real, true church full of Christians being destroyed, yep, you guessed it, from within. Take that however you will. Do Paul and Peter think the culture outside is evil? Sure. But they don't see it as this existential threat. That a false teacher from right here can be to a congregation. There's one thing that you should be absolutely intolerant about, and that is the message of Christ and Him crucified. Because everyone wants to come up here and preach man and Him improved. Why? Because it sells, it's easy, it appeals to me to say it, it appeals to you to hear it, for you to have five nifty tips to have a better life this week. I would love to give those to you. You would love to hear them. Why? Because we would all feel so in control of our lives and a little bit better than the people who don't do those five things. And yet, that's not the gospel. The gospel, well, he tells us in verse 3, is this. To be alive in the Holy Spirit. To glory in Christ, not self. And I'll tell you what it is. It's to brag a lot. It is to boast. It's to boast in the glory of Christ and take no credit. Take no glory for some external right that you did. The glory of your salvation, the glory of anything you've done good in your life, goes to the one who made you, to glory in Christ and the new birth that is found in Him. Let's pray. Gracious God, we thank You that even though Paul has switched topics, the heart of the message is still the same. Humility and joy come from a transformed heart and a transformed life who know that that transformation was alien. It came from outside of us. The alien righteousness of Christ via the new birth by the Holy Spirit. We are the circumcision. We are the people of God, not for any Old Testament or otherwise works that we have done, but because of the glory of Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen.
Our final hymn is 348, My Savior's Love. We get to say, how marvelous my song shall ever be. Shall we stand? Thank you. Thank you, bells.
And now may the love of God the Father, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with and abide with you all, both now and forever and ever. Amen.